joined today by Nick Pidgeon of Visualization. Nick, you've just been doing a fantastic presentation for visitors to the show on rack design and build. What we're looking for, what our viewers need to know is, where do we start with the design? What are the considerations in design? And what are the tips and techniques of building a good rack, a serviceable rack, one that's going to work for a long, long time? And if there are upgrades to be made, how we can design those in early on?
The key really is to think about the design, rack design, prior to the actual build. I think too often everyone's focused on the build and hasn't considered everything they need to in the design phase. So working with AVIXA and the standards group, we've looked at it as process inputs. So they're all considerations that you should think about. That doesn't necessarily mean that they all have an effect. Some of them may not actually be required, but we need to consider them. And from there, we can work out what our conclusion is. So what documentation we require, what rack type we want to specify, how many racks, the depths, the space planning.
Okay, so where are we going to start? If we've got a system, do we need to design the rack first, or do we need to do the entire system?
I think it's key to start the system. And so when we're thinking about it, we split it into two. There's prerequisites that are very much system design. It's not rack design. So you should know your equipment list, a hell of a lot of material from your equipment list based on thermal management, things like that, the heat load. That will give you all the information that then feeds into the next piece. You should definitely have thought about your system design itself. Does it actually work? There's no good trying to design a rack to find your missing key ingredients there. So we need a certain amount of system design in place before we ever think about the rack design and the rack elevation layout, that element.
And is it always best to build rack off-site and then deliver straight to site?
I would always like to. Certainly that's predominantly our way. There is times when you can't, generally site constraints, access to the building. We've worked across commercial, resi, and anything, and in between, you can't always get that rack to its final destination once it's built, but 9 times out of 10 you can. The key to that is you can build it off site where you've got everything in your facility you need. There's no just running out to the van to get this, come back the next day because you didn't have it. There's the ability to test it off site before you ever got there, and there's the ability to build it in the environment and deliver it when the site is ready. I'm sure everyone's been there where they're in that rack room. The carpet layer wants in, there's dust around you, you're on and off and on and off. So wherever possible, build off-site, test off-site, bring it in when the project's ready for it.
You're talking about ventilation being important, of course.
Sure.
There's a lot of heat to dissipate.
Yeah.
Is small always best? Should we try and cram all of our equipment into the smallest possible cabin? I know we're going to try, but yeah. What do we need to consider there?
So that's all around space planning. So where is that rack going? Once you've worked out your total rack units, you can start thinking about how big that rack needs to be. You should be thinking about ventilation space for each piece of equipment. But what I always say is go bigger. We try to build into the AVIXA standard a percent rule, but my advice is always take as much room in that space as you can. So height, even width, more and more often racks are getting narrower and narrower. But where's the cable go in the back of those racks if they're only 19 inches wide? So depth's quite key and width's quite key. So bigger is better in this case, and the more space you can allow for future proofing, we've always been there. You get the job done and then we need to add something. If you haven't allowed that space, that's when we start stacking back to front, squeezing units about to squeeze the space in.
You were talking about cabling, really, really important.
Yeah.
I guess it can be quite easy to make a rack look fantastic from the front.
Yeah.
And then there's a whole rat's nest going on in the back.
Definitely.
But then at the other end of the scale, you can see a lot of racks where the cables have been tied together to look incredible.
Yeah.
But in actual fact, there are negative sides to
cabling
it really, yeah, really tight, everything running together.
Yeah.
Explain why getting that cabling at the back right is important.
I think it's down to serviceability. If it's neat and it's tidy, you can see what you're looking at, you can service it. I think that's the initial. You do need some service loops, and that varies depending on what you're working with. So you may have a wall mount rack that you can't access the back, so we call that an equipment service loop, and it should be enough length to pull that piece of equipment right out and unplug it. In an ideal world, you'd be able to access the back, and then you still need to be thinking about service loops that are long enough to re-terminate those cables should there be any problem. and that's the case. And then really, if you can't get behind the rack but you can pull it out, we'd have what we call a rack service loop, which is a bit like an umbilical or a tail where you can pull the whole rack out. But it's all about serviceability, re-termination, the same things really. And then still on that cable management piece, there's times when we need to use hook and loop, things like that now, so that we're not crushing certainly category cables, digital cables, and that all needs to be taken into account.
What about future-proofing? I guess once you've designed a rack, rack's ready to go, build the rack, it goes in, but then, I don't know, 2-3 years down the line, there is new technology, people want to add new sources, add new distribution. How often do you find that you're going back to a rack and adding more equipment, and do you need to leave space for it?
So I think in a residential environment, yes, seems to be the way it goes. There's always something. So try and build in space within your source section of the rack, build in space within your amplification section. Some people, certainly on an MDU project, will actually plan a hell of a lot of space where they put base level infrastructure. And then when the project's sold to the client comes and says, well, okay, I want to do this, I want to add some kit. So that's key. Commercially, not so much. They're very much systems that are designed, kept in place, and actually we sometimes see the same racks for a project come back round 3 or 4 times over a 10, 15 year period, but we're usually doing a full core upgrade rather than adding bits and pieces.
Going to the rack itself, the actual cabinet, there are a lot of products out there.
Yeah.
And, you know, at first glance, they all look exactly the same. What makes for a good cabinet? What do we need to look out for?
So I think there's two things. Do you want to try and stick to a single brand across your business? You don't need to. You're probably better off not, so that you've got flexibility on cost effectiveness. That's always key to everyone. But certainly use. So when we talk about rack types, we've got racks of solid sides, which are great for managing airflow. We've got frame racks, which are great for passive, if you've got a passive environment, and let that heat dissipate. We've got pull-out racks that you can mount in a cupboard and swivel. So there really is a rack for every use. Don't think it's one rack fits all. Think about the space, what is used for, what you can, the more room you've got, the better you can plan that rack around, really.
Excellent stuff. And Nick, let's just talk about, are there any other tips that we need to consider? Do you see any mistakes that you find that you're having to fix over and over again? Or is there just tips that when people are starting on their first racks that they should consider?
I think certainly, I always stress pre-plan that rack elevation before you're in build. So many people are thinking about the rack elevation the day they start the build. And we've all been there. I do it in every session I teach. I ask people and they all chuckle, because you get halfway up and what you thought was going to fit doesn't quite fit, and then you strip it all out and start again. Just take that time to plan it, and people always say, what products? And you can use as little as an Excel spreadsheet to work out use spacing and work out a plan. You get it wrong, you delete it and build it again. It saves so much time when you hit that rack.
And I guess finally from me, other things to consider. One is security, let's say in a commercial environment, but then in a residential, is there a need to design out that hands-on accessibility, do you think?
So commercially, I think there's two sides of it. There's security for theft. We do a lot of higher education in our business, and quite often you don't want people stealing from the racks when they're left in the room. But the other one is tampering. You don't want people fiddling with settings. So you might want to use security fixings to stop someone physically removing the kit from the rack, but you may want to use a kind of tamper-proof panel to stop people changing settings on there. In the resi world, not so much. There certainly is always that you don't, as much as it's the client's kit, you don't really want the client fiddling with it. But that's probably more into the ergonomics of the design of what's there for them to access, what's not, what do they really need to get to and what they don't. But does it need to be locked away? I'd probably say not.
Nick, some great tips there. Thank you so much for helping
us
out. Plenty more advice at HowToAV.tv on audio, visual, installation and system design. Join us again soon.